Let me tell you the anecdote of how I got into that, since you're starting your academic lives or just passing through academic life. Because, you know, we think it's like a grand like plan to write these books, but it just really happens. So I moved to Ecuador because I graduated with a PhD in international relations studying human rights. And I didn't have any professional experience by the time I graduated because I didn't really care about academia. So I was busy like doing, like going to the beach and traveling, and every free time I had.
You did a few other things.
Every time people were reading, I was like, let's go to the beach, we can read at the beach, come on, right? I lived in Miami. So I really didn't care. The only place that gave me a job, long story short, was in Ecuador. And I went to Ecuador because I wanted to paraglide
in
the mountains.
The national
paraglide. And there's too much wind in the Andes, so I ended up mountain climbing. And mountain climbing, I would go through the villages and see all of the indigenous women, these beautiful old women who looked 100 years old, right, with very marked faces. And then I realized that there were not 100, that there were 50, and I'm like, oh, there's a problem of health and poverty here, right? So I started just inquiring. And then, before you know it, I was like doing research about gender within the indigenous movement. My focus was on human rights. And I ended up coming here because there was an opening at Amherst College on gender and ethnicity in Latin America. Indigenous women was kind of like right on, visiting. And after 2 years, I thought, okay, I'm going to leave. And Amrita was, oh, what about, you know, where are you going next year? Do you want to stay a third year here? I'm like, no, no, no. And my goal, I had saved money. I was like, I'm gonna go backpacking and paragliding in the Himalayas. And fuck, I didn't. And then she's like, what are you gonna do? So I made up at Amherst Coffee in 2010 that I was gonna write a book about indigenous women. Totally made up as I'm having coffee and venting out of my head from the women in the highlands, right? From the Ramache case, because I knew that's the case of the Ramache case. I wanted to write this chapter, Self-Determination with Gender Parity. I wanted to write this paper. That's what I had in mind to do with the mountain climbing. And Amrita is like, oh, send me your CV, I'll try something. And she figured out a Lowenstein fellowship. And she said, oh, you can write your book here with all the comfort about indigenous women. I'm like, oh, now I have to write a book about indigenous women. And I was, you know, so young and stupid that I thought I would write it in a year. So this is 2010. Now it's 2017. I just signed today the contract with Arizona Press. This book is finished. Took a little longer than I thought, right? But it starts with this chapter and this history of indigenous women friends, because I'm very good friends with Christina Kukuri.
Well, you brought here to the valley, right?
Yeah, she came, and she told me anecdotally at Christmas that they had done that, and I'm like, wait, this is kind of important, right? And it went completely under the radar. And it ended up from a paper, it became a book because of coincidences of life. And so, because we have to make sense, right, how do we make sense of this little story of women in Chimborazo influencing the constitution and asking for gender parity within indigenous justice? What does it mean beyond society, international relations, right? You try to like look globally. And then you realize that it's so important. That's what the book is all about. The book is called Vernacular Sovereignties, Indigenous Women in World Politics, or Shaping World Politics, I think. But it's like, this struggle may look very anecdotal. It's the highlands of Ecuador, it's just a group of 100 women.
No, it's only 100 women.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
And none of them, like, only Christina went to school, like finished high school and went to university, right? So most of them are illiterate too. They don't have like political projection or aspirations. They just want to have a better life on a daily basis in their communities, right? But it matters so much because when I started looking around, nowhere in the world there were women within indigenous justice. The idea of gender parity within electoral system is common, but the idea of gender parity within legal systems and judges doesn't exist anywhere, not even in the most modern and equal constitutions.
So, and you know that? So there are like all these quotas that you hear about, and this is a big, as you well know, this idea of gender quotas has been very big in Latin America in particular. But when they talk about gender quotas, they're talking about usually electoral lists. So every party has to present a list of candidates that has at least 30% women. Of course, if they're all 30% of the candidates are women, then the percentage of those who are finally elected is usually way lower, right? But that's supposed to be the big innovation, is, right, these gender quotas But as Manuela points out, that I had never quite seen that. That's about the legislative branch. It's not about the judicial. That's never been challenged as a male preserve.
So. And one of the people who revised this chapter is Joan Scott, who's one of the founding mothers of feminism as a category of analysis. And she was like, wow, right? Indigenous women are doing that because it is innovative. But we can only see it if we look at indigenous women, beyond indigenous peoples, but indigenous women in particular, as political actors and actors of change, right? And not just something folkloric, anecdotal. And this is really just of a, I don't know if like methodological, epistemological effort of taking seriously the margins in general, right? The peripheries. Whether they're LGBT peripheries, sexual peripheries, ethnic peripheries, racial peripheries, or if they're peripheries in global geography, right? These highlands of Ecuador, why would they matter for world politics if we're really talking about Iraq and Afghanistan and Trump and Brexit, right? Why do they matter? Because they're providing other ways of doing politics. They're showing other pathways. So these two chapters, the book is has a first chapter that shows the situation of indigenous women, poverty, violence, political participation, or lack of political participation, not only at the national level, but within the communities. And the second chapter is actually this one, chapter 4. My bad, I probably missed telling you which one was which.
They're both called, chapter 4.
Yeah, this is the Sam Church is the 4. So this is the second one, The Inheritance of Resistance, because the idea is that behind these invisible women from Chimborazo today, there's a history, right? There's centuries and millennia of history of women being authorities with respect, with power, with bargaining power, military power, political power, spiritual power in their communities. And we can see that everywhere. So in this chapter, I focus on the Andes and on the case of Ecuador, but I also give some examples of the Delaware women, right? The Delaware peoples were called a nation of women. All of their authorities, their highest authorities for international negotiations were women. So for instance, when the British or the colonial governments, right, from Philadelphia and Massachusetts would go negotiate with them, the men would always be, where are your women? It's like, we won't negotiate just with a bunch of guys, because these are like the sub people, right? The top people who make the decisions are not here. Where are your women? Like, where are your real people to negotiate? And you can see that example throughout the Americas, right? Pre-colonial Americas. So I give some examples of Ecuador and the Andes. In the less colonial, but the most contemporary history, there are two women in particular who marked the foundation of Ecuador's indigenous movements now. It's Dolores Caguango and Tránsito Maguaña. I got to meet
them. I thought Tránsito was the name of an organization, but no, it's the name of a person.
It's a woman, and there are a couple of organizations after her name now. Actually, Dolores has, right? Isn't there like Misión Dolores Caguango or something? Yeah. The government appropriates the name to make social programs now.
Oh. Tránsito Maguaña is an indigenous leader, and the last time the government beat her up was at her house. She was 98 years old. So she was repeatedly beat up, you know, just chilling in her tiny house in the middle of nowhere. And so, you know, but then when she was 100, she gets like this prize of the government recognizing her labor, whatever. She was like, yeah, take her prize.
So she was one of the voices, and like one of the anecdotes that I really like, because it shows what it means to be an indigenous woman, is that when there was the agrarian reform, she was not given a piece of land, because in the model was a very patriarchal model of agrarian reform, and it's the head of it's the male head of the household who gets the land. And since she was not in a household and there was no male attached to her, she could not apply for a piece of land. So she fought for the agrarian reform. She was one of the four or five founders with Dolores of the Federación Ecuatoriana de Indios in the 40s. And when there's the agrarian reform in the 50s, she does not get a piece of land. That's really ironic. And that's kind of what it means to be an indigenous woman, not only in Ecuador, everywhere. So that chapter finishes kind of looking at why, if there is all this legacy of female leadership, why is it that there's so few women in today's indigenous politics? And my...
Did you get that? I mean, I must say I was shocked because I read the Christina Cocordi chapter first.
Right.
And then I read the History of Indigenous Women chapter and I'm like, wow.
What part shocked you?
The end, where you say, after all of this extraordinary history of resistance and women are completely marginalized in, you know, post-uprising Ecuadorian politics. So I don't know. Yeah, that. So that's the problematic you set for yourself. But it certainly came as a shock to me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And they were pretty present until Tránsito. Tránsito still lives, and there's a generation after her. She dies in 2009. Mm-hmm. And after Tránsito, there is Blanca Chancoso and Nina Pacari, who still. But they're really the last one. After them, a couple of young women here and there. They're individual women, but as a force, women are really like falling through. And my theory developed with Cristina actually, which the institutionalization is that they play institutions like the state way, and the state way is the patriarchal way. So women are set aside. That's one. Two is that the whole agrarian reform was really supported by liberation theology and, you know, the leftist side of the Catholic Church, which was very nice, but it also brought the Catholic Church in, right? And so there is a gender divide and gender roles that are explicitly and implicitly imposed and fixed onto indigenous experiences of politics. So that excludes women a little more too. I think those are the factors. I forget which one.
Does anybody remember?
The politics, Ecuadorian politics being very patriarchal, and the indigenous movement in order to, like, I guess, assert themselves needed to adapt to that.
Uh-huh.
And kind of leave women in the private sphere instead of being in the public sphere.
Mm-hmm. And this, so thank you. the main reasons I identified, there might be others. And they might be contested. And then this other chapter.
Can we say something about that? Because you're right, it is the left. It is because after the 1940s, indigenous organizing gets subsumed within communism or the left as a global left.
Mm-hmm.
So it has everything to do with that. And the left as political party left is part of it, but it also, it's just what we were discussing in the summer, right? The summa causa and the left cannot coincide, cannot coexist.
Yeah.
It's still bourgeois democracy.
Because if we think about communism, it's kind of the same. Communism did bring women into the ranks, as long as it was authoritarian. Like in Cuba, there is a very high percentage of women in parliament, but parliament has no power, right? But once you see post-communist countries, the participation of women is not very high in politics, actually.
Sorry.
In Cuba.
In beyond Cuba, in post-communist countries.
In post-communist countries, yeah, right, of course.
So to which extent did communism really change the gender gaps and stuff?
Well, Nicaragua is the interesting case, right, which we looked at. Not that, but Nicaragua.
Okay.
Well, just the way in which a feminist movement emerged out of that, out of that time. Not that women achieve positions in power within
but
the Ortega, but they emerge as a movement, which from what it seems to me that what your analysis is pointing to is that taking power, becoming a party and taking power is not good for women. I mean, do you remember, I was thinking that.
What?
It's
not good for anyone.
Well, but the fact that, so it was, you know, the movement that sort of seeped through or that was prepared, if you will, by women's participation in Sandinismo, but they were, you know, the promise that was defeated led women outside Sandinismo into a feminist movement. And if you remember also the mothers of the Plaza de Mayo, that they stayed really cohesive until the dictatorship ended and, you know, democracy came in, and that's when they became divided because the state was able to move in and divide them, fragment them, and ignore them essentially because, as you say, the state
became
irrelevant. They weren't listened to, you know. Anyway, the sons reemerge and the mothers are sidelined. Huh?
Margaret, I'm piping up like you predicted. Hello?
Yes, we hear you. We're waiting your pearls.
So it is really interesting. So to kind of brief definitely contribute to the discussion and kind of, you know, drawing some broad, you know, thematic kind of parallels with, you know, the South Asian context. I mean, what I see emerging from the discussion is three things. One is, you know, the participation of women and the terms on which they participate. That even when women participate, they seldom set the terms of their own participation
right.
in these movements. And that is kind of one thing, like one lens to kind of keep using as we look at kind of different contexts across Latin America and even comparative contexts. And the other thing which you're talking about, that, you know, taking power is not kind of good for women. And I kind of heard Manuela say that it's not good for anybody. So this is kind of one of those paradoxes that, you know, that power corrupts, right? So there is a corrupting influence of, you know, the of the act of taking over power and, you know, exercising power, right? And this is much broader, and even from South Asian context, and I can go into this later when I talk about South Asia, like successful, when resistances have taken the form of actually coming to power, for generations who lived through that, they perceive multiple acts of betrayals, right? In the process of a resistance becoming, you know, a government. You know, and this is partly linked to, you know, what it does to women's participation, but it is also what it does to kind of students' participation or, you know, participation of the more radical elements within kind of the movement. So that was really interesting to me. And the other thing which I'm going to briefly state, which was fascinating for me, so this issue of quotas or gender quotas, in the legislature is something which has been debated in India for very, very long. And it's something which we have not been able to implement. And I'll just kind of briefly mention this so that, you know, in the class, if you folks are interested, I'll find a way to integrate this. But this is kind of a fascinating parallel that comes up of, you know, what does reservation for women in the legislature mean? Right, in terms of, you know, empowering women's participation. So, yeah, did you get that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. We totally, you're right, you can all hear her.
Yeah, over there. Yeah. We're all taking notes.
I just want to comment on one thing that really struck me about the way in which power works vis-a-vis women, is the offer that was made to Nina Pacari mm-hmm. and the other woman.
Blanca,
you're welcome. You're welcome to have some power here in the Conai, but only if you become indigenous spokespeople and not women spokespeople, right? Mm-hmm. So, boy, what an offer! And they took it. Mm-hmm. So that was very discouraging. Yes.
Yeah, and they're the only. But they took it, and they became icons, and they gained the voice. And the other women are totally invisible. Nobody knows their names.
Mm-hmm. But my impression was that they no longer advocate as women, or
well,
not.
They tried for a while, but they were so crushed that mm-hmm. completely went underground.
Can I just ask one other question? Because we've also looked, not so much in this class, but a little bit about the role of the church in Mexico and in the formation of the Zapatistas via liberation theology. Mm-hmm. And ironically enough, it was the Catholic Church that promoted women's participation. Oh, absolutely, and enabled it. I don't know whether that has to do with the fact that there were nuns, you know, floating around, but the church became one of the few places that indigenous women were able to leave the house to go to, and the church really fostered that. And they actually organized the Chiapas-wide women's organization under the auspices of the
right,
church.
About that, working with you
Just about everybody. Melissa Ford, I can give you a lot of people who talk about it. Yeah.
I should mention a paragraph about that to compare.
Yeah, it just, that's why I was surprised. I mean, I know that, yeah, that Ecuador, the power of the church is extraordinarily strong.
Mm-hmm.
But in Chiapas, I mean, obviously, the church is against abortion, and that's a problem. And there, you know, that, I think you guys remember reading that the church would only allow promotion of birth control to married couples, whatever, and that, you know, the various other organizations tended to agree. But apart from that, most sort of the thing that you would expect from the church, they were a huge spur to organizing women. And I would maybe argue even that the church made the left have to take women into account, because they were already organized in women's groups when the FLN arrived. I mean, much to everybody's surprise. I mean, the Ecuador story is the more typical one, or the more, the one we would anticipate. So, yeah, I don't know. I mean, you mentioned one outstanding padre who supported the agrarian reform.
Right.
In Chiapas, there were 7,000 catechists. Yeah. You know, so that's, you know, that's a, it's a, it's a whole different organizational enterprise that they engaged in. And since women are always the ones anyway, you know, the men are always ambivalent about the church. They're off getting drunk. And so, you know, as the church was doing its evangelizing, they realized, I mean, for whatever reason, they had to take women into account. So anyway, that's just...
Very good. And yeah, I'll get some references from each other paragraph.
Sorry, so then we come to the really amazing chapter.
Yeah, and so this last chapter, this which is not the last one, but the case study chapter of the book is telling the story of the Red de Mujeres Quichuas de Chimborazo, which is Cristina Cucuri, right? And it's really cool because she told it to me like, oh, did you do this here? And she's like, oh, we passed that in the Constitution. I'm like, wait, say that again? Oh, you know, like it finally passed and it's in the Constitution. And it was in no newspaper, no scholar had talked about it. The indigenous authorities were not talking about it. It was like irrelevant for everybody. And it's the story of a group of women saying, you know, first organizing around domestic violence and health issues in the community, that then when there is the Constitutional Assembly, okay, let's do our own proposal. You know, women are already doing abortion and reproductive rights, they're already doing labor rights, they're already doing, what about law? Because this is where, you know, we don't have access to justice. And by the time we get access to like state justice, I mean, white women don't get it, so forget about us. So let's try to fix our communities, right? It's immediate, it's accessible, we're indigenous too, so it's...
In some way, what's going on in this country right now is so emblematic of that. So the women in migrant communities right now, undocumented women, the last thing they'll ever do is report domestic violence, because both their, I mean, they might want to get their partner off their back, but they don't want to get them deported, because there goes, you know.
Or themselves deported.
And then not only the partner, but also themselves. So the state is not recourse for people who are doubly already marginalized. So it's not, I mean, I think that indigenous women expect to be humiliated, disbelieved, not taken seriously, and not, you know, so there is no justice for them through the state, okay, so.
And there is not even justice for white women who are victims of domestic violence. How are they gonna have it, right? If white women in the city, in Quito, don't have justice, forget about us, right?
Today they were sentencing the guy that raped the indigenous girl
in Colombia.
Yeah. And they were gonna, I mean, not even hear the sentencing, but I think they're gonna give him 51 years.
Yeah, they did.
In jail, which is as much as they can give him. But yeah, for that to happen, the entire country had to hear about it.
And that's Colombia.
And
Colombia has a judiciary that works much
better.
It's
Colombia, it's in the context of the peace accords, it has all these other things happening. Why we heard about this one girl when this happens to girls every day and we don't hear about it.
And so the women in Chimborazo, they first decide to do it, and it's hard because they don't have the legal language, and as you see, the lawyer are like, no, that's impossible, doesn't exist, right? You can't advocate for women's rights within indigenous justice. And they keep going forward, but with nothing, right? And knowing that the women's movement is not for them, that the indigenous movement is against them.
The lawyers are against
them. The lawyers, like nobody's helping them. They don't have NGO money, they don't have, like, they're really on their own. And they're like, but wait, if women's rights in the world is the result of a history, is an invention, then we want to invent our own rights too, right? So they keep going. And it's really moving because they believe in themselves because they believe in themselves. And even though there is this crushing of indigenous women leadership, you can see that there is some roots there, because they still think, okay, well, let's try, let's go as far as we can. And they never thought it was going to go forward. So when it goes forward, it's finally institutionalized through 1 year of lobbying and not being let in the Constitutional Assembly, and then being let in and negotiating, despite their status of, you know, just being like the cleaners of the room, being taken for cleaners. And when it passes, like total silence. No, it's not acknowledged by anybody.
And so this is, do you understand this Constituent Assembly was to rewrite the Ecuadorian Constitution? This is what's happened all over in the Andes where, and other places where indigenous or other radical movements have come to power. Almost the first thing they do, equally in Bolivia, is they hold a constitutional convention and they refound the nation. It's a very, very big deal to reimagine the nation.
I think the United States is the only country that has never changed its constitution in the world.
Well, we had a few amendments, but we didn't start all over. We have amendments. We don't, right.
You don't have a constitutional like the French. They have fifth republics or sixth republics.
Oh, at least can they rewrite the constitution?
They call it a new republic. So okay. Now we're in the fifth or the sixth republic.
So we're in the first, the one and
the first one only. Yeah.
So this rewriting the constitution, refounding the nation, that's the context these women decide, okay, we're gonna be part of the of the nation and its refounding.
Yeah. And one of the arguments or the concept that Cristina kept repeating was democracia con diversidad, right? Democracy with diversity. And she kept saying, no, democracy for you in Amherst, for you in Quito, for you in Cuenca or in the Highlands cannot look the same, right? You need different rights in different places. You cannot have just like the police stations for women, like Comisaría de la Mujer, in the Highlands. Like, you live in the countryside. First, you cannot go there, it's too far, etc. Second, you have to take care of your animals, so it's not like you can, you know, keep going, spend 3 days, or go to these shelters for women for a week. You can't leave your animals, you can't leave the cows alone, right? So it's not an option. So the systems have to be differentiated to our realities. And why is it always a system of protection that's based on urban women's realities? We want a protection that addresses our realities. And the realities in the Amazon and the Highlands are not the same. So even within indigenous women, right, has to be a localized justice. And so that goes forward with little impact conceptually in the nation, but it's there on paper. And for them, it's a major impact because they imagined something and it's, you know, all of a sudden they were traveling for the first time, many of them, and they're facing all these, you know, like men in ties at the Constitutional Assembly, which was a big deal, and exposing their ideas to them. And these most powerful people in the country were listening to them, right? Them who are walked upon, who are mistreated all the time, all of a sudden they're the ones speaking, talking about can the subaltern speak? They're talking in the most important political space in the nation. So it really changed their self-image and their understanding of what politics is and how they can take care of their cows and do politics. And that's something also that's very underestimated, right? The construction of agency through these movements. It's made left invisible.
That's a really important analytical tool when you're looking at the emergence of movements. And we've talked somewhat about this. Now, how do you think about movements? Do you evaluate what they achieved? Mm-hmm. And how do you measure or account for those achievements? So in this case, it's a dramatic achievement, you know, in terms of having an impact on the Constitution, even as Manuela says, it's neglected. So is that the end of the story? Or how do you look at the impact that these movements had on transforming, mm-hmm. creating agency and transforming women's sense of what they can do, what they can be, what freedom might look like, all of that. So how do you make sure that those transformations become part of history and not dissipated into the air? So yeah. I love that. I love that image of these women who've never traveled, going to the beach. I mean, first they, and also the never having left the, I loved what you did with Horizon. You know, their horizons change. Literally, they've never seen the ocean. They've never gone to the beach.
But that is a very old colonial trope for Latin American thinking, for Ecuadorian thinking. Ecuador is a country that's a tiny, it's called a tampon country, right? So it blocks two big countries, like we're a Britain, like to keep them from fighting. So Uruguay is like that, Switzerland, Belgium, Ecuador. There's a bunch of us, right? So we're in between two big guys. And so it was set up in colonial times away from Peru, and they were obsessed with finding an access to the ocean. And this idea of going to the ocean, it's a very big thing in Andean thinking within Ecuador. It totally ruled the policy making and the anxieties of people throughout the 16th and 17th century, and even today there's a big division between the highlands and the coast. And the first soap opera, Ecuadorian modern soap opera, it was about this kid, and this kid, his whole dream was going to the ocean. And when you talk about the narration of migrants, there's a lot of Ecuadorian migrants here in Northampton, and I did ethnography of their migration and how they end up in Northampton, most of them Quechuas too. And that's the thing, that when they are migrating, the meeting point is at the beach. And that is another image. It's a recurrent image in this idea of like forming a nation is like the Andes is standing on the ocean, which is constantly taken away from them. That freedom is something that keeps on moving away and away. Mm-hmm. And the other thing is what you were talking about, the what's different until the ¿cómo se llama la tránsito Maguay y la Dolores Cucuango? I was thinking, even for us to, like you think of George Washington, you don't think of George Washington and the lady in the horse next to him. Well, but in Latin America, within the Andes, this conception of man-woman has been always there. And the indigenous protest, there was a male leader, there was a female leader. And in the revolution, they were the Bolivars, the Washington version, right? And the Sucre, but then there were the women next to them with their horses. And in the Mexican Revolution, you know, the Mexican Revolution, they were all the soldaderas, the women, and, you know, with their weapons too. So this is a reason why we even adore Virgin Mary, right? There was no adoration of Virgin Mary too much until the conquest of the Americas, when you start talking about gender. And so this idea of parity is kind of constitutive of every moment of the imagination of the state within the Andes. And it's a longer memory, and that's something that a lot of people can't see, is the longer trajectory of memory and the constitution of
the state. Is that sort of your argument?
Not really. No? I mean, it appears a little bit, but
the history resistance.
Yeah. No, because I think complementarity is like there is a story there, but in practice today it doesn't happen.
It doesn't.
Men are not practicing.
No. But I thought what I heard from Antonia is that when you remember the uprisings mm-hmm. in the Andes in the colonial period, you think of Tupac Katari,
yes,
and
yes.
You know, his wife, mm-hmm. sorry, if I can, yeah. Who's Bartolina Sisa is. Yeah. Whereas we don't remember George and Martha Washington or Abraham Lincoln.
And you cannot think of Bolivar without thinking of the Manuela.
So just this idea that the memory of rebellions and rebellious leaders, that the next person they're going to read is Julieta Paredes, who takes on the complementarity. Yeah. This idea, so the idea is in the indigenous communities, we don't need feminism because we already have complementary traditions. That's our tradition. Yeah. And patriarchy is a colonial imposition. So that's what you're trying to
Well, no, we need
displace.
Feminism every day. Of our lives.
So wait, let me just finish the two arguments, because then we go to this conversation. But the two things to get from this case study is that, one, it's an unprecedented legislation in the world. It doesn't exist anywhere in any constitution. So not only Ecuador is leading with that constitution, but it's indigenous law, right? It's only indigenous law that has the gender parity. So normative change for human rights does not necessarily come from the UN. It can come from a little indigenous communities that can inspire the world. That's what human rights is all about. And then the other idea that's important, that's more theoretical, to solve these debates between feminist studies and cultural studies, is culture bad for women, right? The whole Susan Okin argument
don't think they know that.
Yeah, so that, but you recognize it because there's this whole thing, you know, the Muslims treat women bad and they force them to wear the veil, and right, it's a sexist culture. And so it's good to go towards less religious culture and to have less culture and more rights, right? So this secularism. Secularism is good for women, and religion or cultural norms can put women down and oppress them. And that's that lasting argument of feminists, and there's a struggle like, no, but are some cultures good, or is the problem culture? Is violence culture in the first place, right? So there are many debates in the field. And what's interesting about this little case study is that it's a group of women without any concept of feminism that is doing feminist push from within the culture, right? So an indigenous culture which is sexist can also be feminist. It all depends who has power within the culture, right? And they wanted the same. It's not about saying, oh, our culture is better because women have power and we have, you know, female presidents. In indigenous communities, women are striving for the same thing, right? And what is, cultures are hybrids, and culture are always permeating each other, right? And political systems are permeating each other. For instance, one of the arguments why the United States Constitution was never rewritten and the state never refounded is because in the first place, it was inspired from the Iroquois Confederacy system. And there are very solid foundations that come from indigenous politics. I don't know, you know, that's another debate, but there's certainly an influence there. So that's that little, in practice, the theoretical debate between culture and women's rights gets solved because you solve women's rights within culture, right, by shaping culture and by allowing women to shape their own cultures, not by, by resisting and forbidding culture, whether it's Muslim or... And, you know, if we think about the Muslim world today and the Muslim sexism that, you know, is bad and violent and undermines women, in the 1600s, European women were converting to Islam because they had more rights and they could divorce and have property rights within Islam that they could not have within the Catholic Church. Right? So things are not static and things are changing all the time, right? What does it mean that a culture is bad for women, right? And how do we shape politics beyond culture? So this is the chapter that follows that is it's more of a theoretical chapter about sovereignty and how that impacts our understandings of sovereignty, because indigenous women are influencing international norms, but at a very local level, right? And so they use the state, they use international norms, but to shape norms in the local. But these local norms, they become a possibility in the global too, right? So there is a multi-scale interaction between global, regional, national, and local norms. But we can maybe have a conversation and then stop talking.
Phew, that's quite an overview. So how does Abatista women, so the big issue that propels Christina Krikorti and the women of Redditch is violence against women, right?
Yeah, she works on health originally, right? So she's working on women's health in the community, community health kind of thing. But then they sort of realize what's the main problem for health is domestic violence. That's the number one. Rape, sexual violence, beatings in the house, Sundays after they drink, right? So, and really alcoholism and domestic violence is treated as a problem, and many women see their husbands or fathers as sick from the, you know, that masculinity, a violent masculinity being a disease, literally. And they talk about it as a disease. And so how do you treat the roots of the health problem, right? Get rid of masculinity or that type of masculinity.
So the same problem really affected Zapatista women, and you remember what they did. How did they respond to domestic violence?
They prohibited alcohol.
Banned alcohol.
Yeah.
Which, you know, is possible to do probably when you're a movement.
Yeah, when you're an autonomous, when you establish autonomy or a separation from the state, which is different in this case because they're using legal institutions or the pre-existing institutions to create reform movements or mobilize.
They use the Revolutionary Women's Law.
Yeah.
Against
the men.
Yeah.
But you know what kept striking me? I don't know whether, and this would be something for those who are going to Chiapas to really explore. I mean, have the How is Indigenous justice in the autonomous communities administered? By whom? And are there women judges? I mean, I think that's a really, because that's the innovation.
It's not in the Zapatista women's law. So an anecdote that I don't know if it was clear from the chapter, but Cristina knew about the Zapatista women's law and she got inspired from that. Because when they went to look on Google to find other...
It's not great.
They didn't, when the lawyer didn't want to help them, they're like, we'll just go on the internet and get from some other country, some other indigenous people, but they didn't find anything. And Bolivia was doing the constitution, and in Bolivia there was no mention of indigenous women. It was just like, you know, the Bolivianos are equal, men and women are equal, but there was no indigenous, within indigenous people, you know, indigenous women have rights. There was none of that. And the only thing they could find was the Zapatista women's law. But that's not within the state, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's a declaration of the community. Mm-hmm. And they wanted something that was in legal paper within the constitution so they could use it if needed.
Well, because they are right now in Zapatista communities talking about revising the Revolutionary Law of Women. I mean, that's a big discussion that's going on. So I mean, I'm very interested.
Why?
I think it has to, that it was written in 1993 and they learned a lot over time, and they think they have to revise it to take account of the new way that they see the world and the way they understand the problem. So, yeah. So, the only thing I've heard them say concretely is that they realize that stress and suffering are a cause of women's ill health. So, patriarchy contributes, and male power as making women sick, mm-hmm. and they have to somehow incorporate that into the Revolutionary Women's Law. The women have the right to health, or something that, you know, against. Yeah, you were there, right, Shiro? And they were talking about that.
Yeah, I forgot about it actually until you just.
Yeah, so, but we can ask them, I mean, that's something, I mean, one question that, of course, you want to ask is about land rights,
mm-hmm.
and which is sort of so interesting in Ecuador and the stories that you tell about what the path to access to land is,
mm-hmm.
you know, through that one household gets land access, and that's always bad.
And that was throughout, like, I mean, now it's not like that anymore, but all of, you know, if you think about Salvador Allende, who was doing the revolution in Chile, and that, you know, killed by Pinochet and all that, they were doing a redistribution of land that was minimal, and that was to male households, like male heads of households. So everywhere where you have, like, revolution and redistribution, agrarian reforms, it's for a man. Right, so there's a very clear gender divide in any through the 60s and 70s throughout the region.
So what are your questions or comments?
Just thinking about the alcohol move that the Zapatistas did, the missionaries in the Amazon, the Summer Institute of Linguistics, when they reduced the Waorani into towns, they introduced alcohol, and that's one of the reasons why the Huaterero separated the Huaorani, sorry, from the separated, and because they experienced for the first time domestic violence, which they hadn't before. Uh-huh. And they immediately blamed the alcohol. And so when the Tagaeri, the Teromenani, left, one of the reasons they put to leave was that they had alcohol and there was domestic violence, and that was insane.
Huh?
Yeah. It's really fun. I've never thought about that, but now that you mentioned the Zapatistas banning alcohol, it's like, yeah, mm-hmm. there's something to that.
Well, the church was also against alcohol. Do you know why? Why did the Catholic Church and Liberation, I mean, remember the FLN was against alcohol, I think, for security reasons, right? Because they're organizing a clandestine army, and they're afraid that, you know, people are getting drunk, they're gonna talk. So they were really happy about the idea of banning alcohol. But it was really the women who were able to accomplish it. The church was also against it. Why do you think the church would be against alcohol? Any ideas? Yeah.
You just said it.
Oh, well, you
said
it too. What did you say? I didn't hear it.
She said sex.
Oh, sex. What, the alcohol
sex.
Promotes sex? Well,
worse.
There's probably that, too. What were you going to say, Kia? That's, you were going to say sex,
yeah.
too? I thought, okay, I thought.
Alcohol promotes sex.
Of course. I mean, yeah, that's why.
At least in three people's experiences here, it seems to.
Alcohol promotes sex. Very good. I thought, well, that's probably exactly right. I was just thinking in like stupid material terms. Because the men spend all the money on alcohol, and there's not as much to give to the church, but I'm sure it's about sex, you're right. Thank you. Thank you for enlightening me.
Thank you.
I'm glad you two were, yes, thank you. So you're on sex. Okay. Sex, security, and...
It's funny because... The evangelical churches in the Andes now, in Chimborazo in particular, they also forbid alcohol. And a lot of women want their family to join the evangelical church.
Absolutely.
Because then they don't want the alcohol. But the reality is that everybody keeps drinking, but they have to drink in hiding, so they drink much less. And they spend less, and so there's less drama. Even though they are still drinking?
That's totally true in rural Mexico. The spread of, oh, absolutely, the evangelical religions is pushed by the women because they're against alcohol. Yeah, and you're right. Of course they drink.
I have an anecdote that has nothing to do, but that's related. So in the Amazon, because I also work in sexualities and native sexualities, and there's a very funny story from a co-writer of mine, Jose Ticuna, who's a lesbian Ticuna, which is the largest indigenous group in the Amazon. There are about 300,000 people. Colombia, Brazil, Peru, more or less, at the border. And there's an anecdote from one of the communities there. She was doing research about Ticuna women living together, right? Homoeffective relationships among women in the Ticuna community. And one of the cases, the father is a... evangelical priest, however you call it, some priest, it was another name, but the evangelical head of the community, right? And it's like, damn it, like, now that, like, he didn't know what to do, because now that you're, you know, having sex with a woman, you're like the devil, and there's all of these negative stereotypes. So he goes to the cabecera regional, right, to the regional head evangelical person to ask for advice what to do. And the head tells him, well, you know, this is a challenge that God is sending you. So, you know, you're going to the right way, and it's a challenge from God to put your family and your community on tracks and stuff. But this very abstract challenge of God. So he goes back to the community. He's like, okay, so the challenge is that I convince the community that we, you know, homoeffective relationships don't matter, and we're all sons of God. And so since he was, you know, the one giving all the speeches in the church, he starts saying, you know, the challenge from God is that we all accept each other the way we are, and that we all love each other, homoeffective or not, it doesn't matter, like, it has never mattered in our world before, and it continues not to matter, and it's a challenge God is sending us to be tolerant. And he convinced the whole community, and in that community, homosexuality is like totally fine. Yeah, it's totally fine. Everybody, nobody has a problem with it in the community. Which kind of
indicates the
community? It's fascinating. But because, of course, in the other cases, usually there is like, you know, beatings and repression and hiding. And if not within the family, then the community excludes the family. The family accepts the people. But in that case, because he was the head, he could be the one defining what does it mean. And he went for a framing that was tolerant, right? It's the exception that confirms the norm. But the role of the church in framing what it means, whether it's violence, whether it's women's empowerment, whether it's sexuality, right, can be very strong.
So the church that's powerful in Ecuador and that is embodied in Correa, who, what did he say, abortion over my dead body, something like that.
Yeah, he's aligned with the Opus Dei.
He's alive with the right,
he's
the
Catholic,
old,
but he's alive with the Opus Dei.
Opus Dei is the most right-wing, male, horrible, part of the Catholic
Orthodox,
Church.
But you have to suffer.
Yeah. Is there still a liberation theology tradition, or is it as the church completely right?
I mean, there's a little bit, especially in indigenous areas, right? So. Mm-hmm. There's significant, there's a little bit in indigenous areas in the highlands, in Riobamba, there still is. In Cuenca, I mean, Carlos was meeting with the Archbishop of Cuenca on extractivism, because now it's about resisting the mining companies. And some priests are aligning, and actually the Pope, right, made environmental declarations, but some priests are aligning with indigenous communities against mining companies from China, Canada, the US, and the States. something that's a legacy from the 70s and the 90s in particular, when there's a major crisis, the archbishops are still the ones, the Catholic Church is still the one that's invited to be the mediator between the state and the indigenous movement. That lingers on. Wow. Not systematically, but...
Well, that's, often. I mean, of course, that was also true in Chiapas with the Red Bishop, San Paul Ruiz, who so mediated between the indigenous communities and the government when they had their negotiations of the San Andres Accords. Yeah. So I have another question. Where does the Red Women of Chimborazo, where do they stand on abortion? Is that an issue for them? Or, you know, controlling the number of children they have? Is that at all part of their...
It's something that they don't talk about. And actually, one of the meetings we had, I started saying I was raped and I had abortions. Kind of to like, let's talk like openly about these things. And it helped because they also started talking a little more, but never, you know, it was like, I heard a story, like, there's a woman in my community that happened, right?
But they don't
advocate abortion. But obviously there is management, because a lot of the indigenous women I know in the Andes, like most of them, they have 1-2 kids.
Really?
That's so awesome. Obviously there is control. It's not like before where they had 10 kids.
Right.
That's the last 10 years. So there's still, you know, there's still some forced marriages. There's really less and less. There's still, if not forced, you know, highly encouraged marriages. But I would almost say that it's almost more common in the middle classes, and the speech anti-abortion is almost more of an icon in the middle classes, urban than...
Really?
It's really underground. Look, the problem in indigenous communities, like, we don't really talk about it, but it's not even accessible in the first place.
Right? It's not?
So it's not.
Because they're not traditional curanderas who know
they're
how
not
to do
exactly, abortion. Exactly, but then you don't frame it as abortion. It's exactly. Not conceptualized as abortion, right?
You
it's
just go and have some
medicines.
Herbs. Uh-huh. Uh-huh, you get a tease.
You go to curandera. Uh-huh.
Because that's my abortion was from curandera, the only one I had. And it was, and that's my perception. It's like, it's just a practice. It's a beverage. It's something you do. It doesn't have the state going with, like, machines into your uterus, you know? It's way different.
It's not hospitalized. It's not health, right? It's not within the whole discourse of sexual... Right? It's within the discourse of health, of the community, ancestral, herbal health.
Uh-huh.
But they, I mean, I know a lot of them use Te de Cobre, like the IUD.
Same. Really?
Yeah, a lot of them.
So that means, but that's from presumably...
Yeah, that's from the state.
From
so
the state, yeah.
It's not really discussed, but it's very common. I think there is also the relationship to the body, right? The body is such a site of colonization and invasion. That discussing the body, discussing sexuality, showing the body is not something that is that you do, right? You're more reserved on the body in the highlands, unlike in the Amazon. The Amazon is much more fluid and open and naked. The highlands is hidden. So for instance, the beautiful girls, there was something until the 60s called Derecho de Pernada. I studied in the text, right?
I don't think so, but that's something that you always say. We talked about again in Chiapas, the right of the first night.
Yeah. So
that is the right of the.
And then before the first night, you know, often the girls were raped. And Tránsito Amagonia is an example. She was married at 14 so that she wouldn't be raped by the patrón, right? So parents would marry the kids early, not because they had a bad culture, but because they were slaves. And then if you don't marry the girls, but then by 15, 16, the patrones are raping them, right, for pleasure and using them. And then they're unmarriable after too, right? So there was that until late. Until the 60s it was legal, but until the 70s, 80s it was still going on. And so the girls, a lot of the time, like in the highlands, it's cold, but they would do like that, right? And this thing about hiding your smile, it's about hiding your face and hiding your beauty, right? So you're less vulnerable to rape, like the patrones. And you do that, you still see in Chimborazo. I mean, less now, but when I arrived in Chimborazo in 2004, you could see a lot of, like, women, like, they would talk to you like that. And there was this, it was just a habit, right? A thing where you just hide. You don't hide just your face, you hide the whole body, right? So talking about the body, also it's cold and all that, but the history of colonization and slavery and Wasipungo made it all the more difficult.
Would you explain the Wasipungo?
Want to know?
Yeah, that's one of the.
The Wasipungo is called Wasipungo Encomienda.
There's when the colonizers arrived in the 16th century.
This is the end. It's throughout the end.
Systems of production that basically set up a global capitalist structure, right? So one is farming for the planet, not farming for your local needs. That farming structure was called encomienda. So the Wasipungo, it's the transformation of this colonial agricultural institution, which requires giant land tenures and a ton of labor that is underpaid or not paid. So it's kind of feudalism slash slavery kind of thing. And so the Wasipungo is the Republican version of this institution. Now, there was a lot of encomiendas that when the liberal revolution and the conservative revolution happened, the liberal revolution kicked the priests out, and some of these priests granted those title grants to the indigenous people that were their subaltern, their working people, but then got access to their land. And that is part of the issues in the Mexican Revolution in the 1905. There were certain legal rights that they had gotten granted, but this is a Latin American phenomenon, right? The liberals kicking out the priests. And that happened in also in certain parts of Ecuador, where the indigenous communities, and what we come to understand as indigenous communities, also follows the separation of land tenure according to Wasipungos and encomiendas. For example, Tránsito Magaña, no?
I don't get it still. So the Wasipungo is the land that...
So there is slavery. Slavery, you buy people, like in the Americas, slavery was you bought people from Africa, you brought them across on the Negreros boats, right, slave traders, and you resold people here to work in plantations, usually sugar plantation, sugar. Right? Coffee later, mining a lot, because the first slaves that arrived in Bolivia was to work on the Potosi, for instance. Potosi Mountain was silver extraction. Another economic system is the Wasipungo Encomienda, which is indigenous peoples, they're like animals that belong to the land, right? So when you buy a piece of land, you buy it with the Indian families that live on it. Okay. And they're not technically slaves, and they were never called slaves, but in practice they're slaves, except they're attached to the land, right? So you don't move them around like the African slaves that were sold and separated and, you know, sold really like labor. This one, they're attached to the lands. In the Wasipungo, and you buy the whole family, right? So you don't separate the family, you don't separate people from the land, but they work for you for free. You have right of life and death as the landowner over them, right? You have the right of to fuck the family and inaugurate the spouses and stuff. But the legal deal is that they are paying rent to live on the land that belongs to you. Right, so you don't kick them out, but they live on that land, and as a retribution for you allowing them to stay on the land, they work for free for you. Right? So they have a little piece of land, they work on your land, planting potatoes, taking care of the cattle, taking care of the house, of everything, and they have their own little piece of land, and they can get the leftover potatoes.
But there's also a system of economy, because in these encomiendas, these big, large, they're basically like a farm slash town, right? So if you want milk, you gotta go to the farm store. And then you don't have money because they're not paying you. And then you have to add these things. And so it adds, you are basically constantly
debt.
We talked about
the debt,
feudal system.
Mm-hmm. It's like also in the US South.
Yeah.
You know, there's a system of debt peonage, which was
Credit cards, let's talk about it right now. Credit cards,
well,
that's what it is.
I think you're all, and we talked about that too, you're all living in a kind of debt peonage.
Yeah.
Right? The longer you stay in school, the more you have to borrow, the deeper you go into debt, etc. So welcome to debt peonage.
And Catholicism.
You're the modern Wasipungo.
Yeah. And Catholicism was really important because, you know, indigenous peoples were considered savages, right? They were expected to civilize through God and stuff. To be baptized, well, to have to go to mass or to like be buried under God, and you had to pay. Right? So each time you create more debt through the priest, and you know, to be a good Catholic, it was expensive, and so it increased your debt. And so the priest and the landlord would work together also to to maintain those debts and accentuate them and keep people into subordination attached to the land.
Okay, I have two very big questions that I, how do you, I mean, this is sort of taking off, but how do you account for the fact that the rights of LGBTQ people, including trans people, are on the ascendancy in Latin America, including
are on the what?
They're doing well.
Oh, okay.
They're being recognized. Right. They're growing. So that in Ecuador, you can change. You can get a new identity. It's like maybe
they didn't change sex.
Well, they say you can't change sex, you can change gender. I don't know if that's true. But anyway, you can get a new identity card. So that the trans movement has had certain successes. Various places in Latin America, I don't know, gay marriage is being recognized, and abortion almost everywhere is, you know, is really shut down. So this to me is the real paradox of sex and gender politics right now and throughout Latin America. So I just want, so that's my one question. And the other one is I noticed in your historical section that over and over again, these women leaders are known for giving flaming speeches.
Right.
And I just thought that was really interesting in a, you know, in a history where they're barely literate or barely educated, and I don't know, they become, I don't know whether that's also because of the church, where they were used to hearing flaming sermons, and they absorb, you know, a certain kind of oral culture and become, I don't know, but I want to ask.
The second one is easier, and then I can talk about that too, but I would say because it's not a literary culture, because they're illiterate, what you have is memory and speech, right? And so they're all the better at memory and speech because they don't have books and they can take notes like we all are.
Right? All right, you said someone memorized the entire labor code, one of those.
Yeah. And I have examples, if I actually should give you as an example, but one of the women in the Chimborazo women's groups, she's the treasurer for the community. They do mini loans within the community, like, you know, $20, $50. And she knows all of the accounts of the, like, 300 families of the community.
Wow.
And everybody loves her because she...
By heart.
All by head. Like, she has it all. She's not written, and she doesn't know how to read and write. She's never been to school, right? So she has just mnemotechnology. I don't know how she does it, but she's
That's
the
wild.
One who is in charge of everything. And she's illiterate. She doesn't even have a cell phone. So it's the least you have paper, the more you use your memory, and I think that's when, you know, their world's lost in translation, because the Inca world, the indigenous worlds, they had ways of communicating and telling history.
They will never walk against a glass door.
Glass ceiling?
Like, you see how people now with the phones, they're always crashing against the planet. You know, indigenous people will never crash against a glass door. They know how to walk and they know how to look when they're walking, and that includes listening, as you will see from the Zapatistas, no?
Yeah, listening is a value. Right?
Very interesting. Thank you. And then tell us about why. Isn't that rather shocking that in Ecuador, this incredibly Catholic country, where the president says over his dead body, will abortion, he'll resign, right, mm-hmm. rather than permit abortion to be practiced, and yet they have a law, whatever it is, gender identity.
Yeah, it's super easy. You want to change, you know, from male to female on your ID, you go into the store, into the registry, civil registry, you leave 3 hours later with a new ID. It's super easy.
And what about gay marriage?
And the president said, you
oh,
know,
right.
over my dead body, but he's like, yeah, you know, people can be whatever they be.
Right. He came out and said,
but I like women who look like women and men who look like men, right? So there's, within this acceptance of, you know, sexual diversity because it's modern, and, you know, the LGBT rights are human rights, and it's a democratic deficit, but within that, he reiterates this, you know, heteronormative binary of the male-female, right? So it's not at all a queer thing. It's really much just like, okay, if you feel you're a woman and you want to be a woman, but you better look like a woman, right? Kind of a thing, right?
Yeah, and isn't he closeted? I think he's a closeted.
No, let's like not go there, because that's all my, that's all my doubt.
We're social scientists, Antonio's
literary. I lost gay friends.
But we don't know about that.
We don't know about that.
What's the thing
about machista society?
But it's part of homosexuality in the Andes. It is part of how homosexuality was until the year 2000. It was a criminal offense.
No, until 19 Ecuador. It's changed because of the thing in Cuenca in the 90s.
In the late 90s, because I remember my friends who were killed because they were gay.
Yeah, but they're still killed. Yeah, right. Then come the contradictions. It's legal to change sex, but they're also still existing and they're tolerated by the government. They're like clinics for dehomosexualization, which are really torture clinics. And those are tolerated by the state. And the state kept saying they're going to close them. And in practice, they're illegal, but they've brand themselves as, you know, detox for alcoholism. But, you know, detox and dehomosexualization is the same because you have toxins in your body, right? You're sick. And it's treated as a disease still. So there are these contradictions. And this is true that it's a trend throughout Latin America, right? That abortion rights are more and more
marginalized. Abortion's really under attack throughout Latin America.
And at the same time, you have the same-sex marriage that's been institutionalized in many countries.
I find this very.
And in Ecuador, you don't have the same-sex marriage, although it's being fought for, but there is, for instance, you know, a same-sex couple that wanted to marry and they didn't let, but it's a very queer couple, and so one of them changed the gender ID for male and they married as male and female.
Oh.
Which in practice, they're very queer, so you wouldn't like, you know, do that fit, whatever. But it's like, okay, we'll just change genders and marry. And so they got married within the system.
There's a couple of
and
trans
people. The president's
had a baby.
Like, well, as long as. Yeah.
Two trans that.
And it's them, yeah. They had a kid. So. But you know, it's the men who got pregnant. And the message is simple. The message is not that indigenous peoples are, you know, the noble savages, that they're better than other people, that they're perfect, but that they have other imaginaries that can expand our imaginary. And one way to look at it is a color. If we tell you now, invent a new color. Just invent a new color. And then describe it to me. How can you describe it if it's new and it's something that I've never imagined? How can I even start to understand the color you have in your head if it's totally invisible to me? And indigenous politics is that it's so different, it's so unthinkable for us that we can't even understand it. But indigeneity is that site where they still have these other colors that we have lost or that we can't see. And that's the value of places like Chiapas, of indigenous women in Chiapas, is to expand our imagination. Even if we can't see them, that maybe we can learn to feel it and eventually learn to see. Hmm. So as you
well, that's a lovely way to end, isn't it? I hope your imaginaries are expanded.
Thank you.
Thank you.